Bury the workmen, but the work will go on. You can gonna be our all-star song. Y'all know it.
Get back up here where you can hear me. Amen. Our offertory song. Amen.
Our joy and the peace and the hope that we have in Christ. So just know these altars are always open. The one thing that we need to do, the right thing to do, the only thing we can really do is be sure that we lay it down to Him.
That's right.
And completely trust in Him and know that we're not alone. Know that you're not alone no matter what it is, even when it feels like it.
Thank you.
I just pray that you just speak to us today, God. We just come with expectant hearts, God, to meet with you. God, we invite you in this place, Lord. This is your house, your people. God, and we just pray that you will just touch us in a mighty way, God. Speak to our hearts. Be prepared to just change lives, God. We expect for you to just touch us. God, we love you. We praise you. God, help us through the circumstances in our lives. As difficult as it seems sometimes to praise you in our circumstances, let us never forget why you went to the cross, God, because of your great love for us, and that we're never alone, God, that only you can sustain us and help us through anything that we're going through, any trials that come our way. We love you and we praise you. It's in Jesus' name I pray. And I think before.
Amen. Don't be running off anybody.
Run off.
Yeah, come on, man. Where's that boy at? Get up here, Carlin.
We have a very special.
I like barking at people. Get up here, Carlin. Don't be grinning at me when I yell at you. I ain't having all that. Come here, right up here. What do you do? You turn 12 today? How old do you get to be? Seven. Seven, that's a good number, amen? Seven's a good number. Let's clap for seven, amen? Amen. Are you still awake? You yawning, man. We'd be yawning at me when I'm talking. Trust me, I get a lot of that, okay? I get a lot of that, amen. All right, so we're going to sing Carlin happy birthday, and before you leave out of here today, when we get done, run back to the fellowship hall. I don't know what's happening, but there might be something happening anyway, okay? So just drop by the fellowship hall. All right. You got like a G or something you can give us right there real quick?
Is it back on?
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Carlin. Happy birthday to you. Woo! Yeah, all right. Amen. All right, all right.
And there's cake and lunch in the fellowship hall afterwards. The cake and lunch.
Anyway, I ain't giving it away. I'll get in trouble. Okay. All right, K-6 heading through their appointed door. Lolly, before you come down, take just a little of the singing edge off of my volume, okay? Just a little bit. Get me down just a little bit. Okay, while they're doing that, I want to go through the bulletin with you because these things are important. How many noticed the construction when you came in? Notice the new construction? All right. That little area has been dubbed the Gathering Grounds because I just like the name, okay? The Gathering Grounds, get it? Coffee, Gathering Grounds, Coffee Grounds. Amen. Everybody's with me on that? Okay. I don't want to overexplain it. But anyway, got started on that. I've had some people working on that. Got others that are painting. Got those that are, you know, everybody that's cooking. I mean, just everybody doing stuff. We've got the ladies that are working with the Benevolence Fund. This is the basket you can win. They've still got the tickets left to sell. $2 a piece, you can't go wrong. I don't know what it all is, but it looks like I see candy, so that's good, amen. Make sure you participate in that, get with them. I'm sure you've got a couple dollar bills to turn loose for that. We've just got people working, amen? Amen, we do, we have people working. And so you know what that means, right? Anybody know what that means? That means we have an enemy that hates that, is what that means. Amen? We get all fired up and get to working and running around doing stuff, this, that, and the other. Well, of course, he's not going to just tolerate that. He's not going to sit back and just accept that. So we need to continue in prayer. And you know what? I'm going to just confess something. I'm just going to, you know, Bible talks about confessing your faults one to another. You know, we get to places, I can get to places where I'm like, well, everything's good, and you feel like you can kind of let the pedal up a little bit. You know, you can just kind of back out, you're just like, okay, I think we're making it there. I think we're finally getting there. And it seems like, and I should know better, but I'm just slow and stupid, I guess. But every time I do that, you just get blindsided from some direction or another. So I'd like to tell you that while you're here on planet Earth, you're going to make it to that point where you can just throw on the cruise control and enjoy it for a little while. But for the most part, probably not. Amen. So stay diligent in our prayers. Stay diligent in your Bible. Stay diligent in reaching out to others. Stay diligent for being there for one another, encouraging one another, loving one another, because we're all doing this thing called life together. Amen. We've got all these issues and situations. So anyway, Wednesday night fellowship coming up. Brother Skeeter with the spaghetti last week. Miss Maggie's cooking this week. Pretty sure that'll be Mexican food. Anyway, it'll be good. I'm sure of that. Okay. So anyway, just looking forward to that. All right. Tonight is our real men's class. Now listen, like I said, we had some misunderstanding about that. If you come to real men's class, you do not have to speak. You do not have to talk. We're just going to talk about guy stuff. Okay. Just specifically the men that God's called us to be, how to handle ourselves, how to conduct ourselves, how to lead our families, how to guide our children, all of those things. So I just want to encourage you to come and be part of that, because you know what? I wish I'd had somebody to tell me that when I was a young man. I really do. I really do. I wish I'd had somebody that just took the Bible and opened it up and showed me what the scripture said about God's expectation and his hope. And like I said, 7th through 12th grade, you young guys, you can come too, because you're maturing into those young men, and I'd be glad to give you a head start. And we don't realize how important it is when we ought to, if we look around and we see the condition of most of the young men you see up and down the street today. Amen. I mean, seriously, do they know how to do these things? Do they know how to function? Do they know how to take care of themselves? Do they know how to take care of a wife? Do they know how to take care of a family? Do they know how to work within their community? How about that one? You know, just so much lack in these things, and it's right here, people. It's right here. We just got to get in there and take a look at it. So the real men's class tonight, 6 o'clock. We've added to this our weekly attendance, man. What was it? Wednesday night, we had 40 people here on Wednesday night. It was amazing. We had our first movie night. We had 20 people come out for the first movie night. That was amazing. We met our goal financially for January. That's amazing. Amen. You go ahead and clap for that one. Amen. That's important. I don't know about you, but I like the lights on. Amen. I like the air conditioning. I'm all about that. So anyway, just be praying about that. And then finally, do not forget, we are on YouTube. Okay, you can direct your friends to it, your family to it. Let them take a look. Encourage somebody to come. Say, look, before you show up, you can take a peek and see what it's like so you're not caught off guard. Amen? We're trying to get accomplished all the things that we can get accomplished. All right. This morning, I need you in the book of Isaiah, chapter 55. We're going to talk about an unexpected outcome. Isaiah chapter 55. And I'm pretty much going to read all 13 verses here, and we're just going to talk about the unexpected outcome. And I'm going to explain that in a minute. I don't want to give it all away, but I do want to give you time to get to Isaiah chapter 55. And we're going to be centering ourselves in on the idea that God doesn't do things like we do things, and he's not going to, and you can't make him. And if you're waiting for him to start getting on the page with what you've got going on, you're going to wait a long time, because he's not going to come in and take, as it were, our offering and our givings and our doings and just come in and sprinkle blessing on top. That's what we act like we can go do what we want to and then just ask God to bless it. We didn't ask him if that's what he wanted us to do. We didn't look for direction in the first place. We didn't seek his leadership in the situation. But you know what? I just want you to bless me as I decide to do this. And you know what? You can do that for as long as you want to, and you're going to just end up very, very frustrated. Amen? Because his ways are not our ways. Same thing in our lives, in our relationships. We try to work things out our way, don't we? In fact, you might be trying to get the other person to do things your way. You think if they just did it my way, this would be a whole lot easier. Everybody get along better, amen? Well, trust me, they're on the other side thinking the same thing about you. If you just take it down a notch and do it the way I do it, this would be a whole lot better. But the whole point is, neither way is going to hold up, because the way we need is what? We need God's way, don't we? I mean, we're the people of God. Don't we need God's way? If we're his chosen, if we're his nation, we're his children, then we need to be doing these things God's way. So Isaiah chapter 55, in verse 1, it says, "Ho, everyone that thirsteth, come ye to the waters. And he that hath no money, come ye buy and eat. Yea, come buy wine and milk without money and without price." He says, "Wherefore do you spend money for that which is not bread?" Now that's a good question. "And you labor for that which satisfies not. Hearken diligently unto me, and eat that which is good, and let your soul delight itself in fatness." And I want to do something as I read through these verses. I just want to kind of give you a little commentary on this. God starts out with an offer of free supply. And then he comes in behind it on verse 2 asking you, why are you working for stuff that doesn't satisfy you? Why are you working for that which is not bread? And that's talking about those things that are not bringing life into your life. Why are you seeking after those things? He said, I'm trying to give you free supply, and you're over here busy working for stuff that's not any good for you. And isn't that what we do? We sit there and just slavishly work away on things that aren't going to amount to a hill of beans by the time it's all over with, while we do without what God's trying to give us for free. Thank you. Thank you. I appreciate that. I'll take all the amens that you want to muster up, okay? All the clapping, whatever. If I stumble across anything good, just jump on top of it. He said in verse 3, he says, incline your ear. He says, listen to me and come unto me here, and your soul shall live. And I'll make an everlasting covenant with you, even the sure mercies of David. Behold, I have given him for a witness to the people, a leader and commander to the people. Behold, thou shalt call a nation that thou knowest not, and nations that knew not thee shall run unto thee because of the Lord thy God and for the Holy One of Israel, for he hath glorified thee. Now that's what I need. I need God to glorify me, not me glorifying myself. I need God to uplift and extol me and place me where he has for me to be. Verse 6, seek ye the Lord while he may be found, and call ye upon him while he is near. Let the wicked forsake his way. Quit doing your junk and garbage. The unrighteous man his thoughts. Quit even pondering the idea of it. And let him return unto the Lord, and he will have mercy upon him, and to our God, for he will abundantly pardon when he shouldn't. Amen. He said, you're guilty, but I'll erase that. I'll take that away. He said, but you've got to forsake. Man, we have lost the term. We have lost that idea. Amen. I just apologize for. I just say I'm sorry. I can't help it, and I can't stop myself, and all that other mealy mouth stuff we do nowadays. It's like, you know what? Be sorry enough to quit. Say, I'm not going to do that anymore. I'm going to discontinue that action and that activity. I'm going to forsake my way. I'm going to return unto the Lord, because when I do, he'll abundantly, Bible says, abundantly pardon me. Not only will he forgive you of the sins that you remember, he'll forgive you of all the ones you forgot. Yeah, that's right. See, I need that. I need that cleansing from all those other ones that I didn't even account as being that important. Amen. He says, and return unto me, and I will abundantly pardon. He says, verse 8, for my thoughts are not your thoughts. And we okay with that. God thinks differently. That's okay. But here's the kicker right here. Neither are your ways my ways. Your ways are not my ways. The way you human beings, you fallen race, go about doing things is not the way I'm trying to get things done. For as the heavens are higher than the earth, he said, just in case you're wondering how much these two things are not similar, he says, for as the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts than your thoughts. Now, that's a pretty distinct difference, isn't it? He said, just as high as the heavens are above the earth, he said, that's how I do things differently than you do things. He said, for as the rain cometh down and the snow from heaven and returneth not thither, but watereth the earth and maketh it bring forth and bud, that it may give seed to the sower and bread to the eater, so shall my word be that goeth forth out of my mouth. Here we are back on the word again. He said, it shall not return unto me void, but it shall accomplish that which I please, and it shall prosper in the thing whereunto I sent it. He said, this is predicated on, based on the word of God, just like rain grows plants. Amen. Just like rain grows grass. And we live in Louisiana, and we know that rain grows grass. Amen? Let it get summertime, about 95 degrees outside, and every guy is looking out, and it's raining, and he's like, I'll be mowing the grass in 2 days, because as soon as it gets wet, it just goes, woof, doesn't it? And you're back out there having to deal with it again. Amen? I try to get on the once-a-week program. Sometimes that don't even work out around here. But he said, just like rain grows grass, he said, my word will grow you. We sang that song, Let It Rain, amen? And we act like that's some distant something somewhere that God just happens to do from time to time, and apart from that, we just do without it. No, he's saying, my word is that needs to be raining on your life, needs to be pouring into your life so that you can grow and become strong. You know why we're weak? Because we're not strong in the word. Oh, amen, preacher, that was pretty good. That's right. We are not strong in the word. I have never learned a Bible verse. I do not have many memory verses at my disposal. I don't even know if my Bible app is still working. I mean, come on, man. No wonder we can't stand against the pressures and the problems and the situations. What do you know of the Word of God and what it says about those issues? And God says, you're trying to do it your way, but there's my way, and my way is the only way that works, and it's so far above your head, you're not going to think of it on your own. He said, you got to look it up. But man, we slavishly seek after that which does not satisfy, don't we? We continue to try to do it our way over and over and over and over and over, and then we blame God for it not working. Yeah. I don't know what's wrong with God. He's not blessing any of this because it's not his way. He says, for you shall go out with joy and be led forth with peace. The mountains and the hills shall break forth before you into singing, and all the trees of the field shall clap their hands. Now, I like poetry. I don't know about you, but that sounds good to me. If I'm kicking it down the street and the hills just start singing to me because they're just glad to see me, amen, and all the pine trees just start like, look at there, there's Tony, amen, praise God, how cool is that? Come on. I mean, God's trying to paint you a picture as opposed to what you normally go through. Don't that sound good, amen? As a matter of fact, it's going so good that even the hills are happy for you. All the little grass things. I mean, you've seen those, I don't remember what movie it was, but those animated movie and the little flowers are singing, amen? Just la, 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 and they're just carrying on, man. Just imagine you're walking along and the flowers are just so glad for you because you're walking in the will of God that they can't hold their peace and they just start singing at you, amen? Anybody want some of that? I mean, if not, I'll just quit preaching. We all go home, okay? But you know what? Not only do I want some of that, I need some of that. I get so tired, so depressed, so frustrated, so overwhelmed with everything I've got going on. I need some movement of God in my life, and I'm trying to give you the information necessary so that you can have it. Amen? Nobody's trying to hurt anybody here, just trying to help. He said, instead of the thorn, shall come up the fir tree. Instead of the briar, shall come up the myrtle tree, and it shall be to the Lord for a name, for an everlasting sign that shall not be cut off. He said, even stuff that normally don't work out will start working out. Now, how blessed is that? Yeah, I need some of that. Let's pray. Father, we come before you right now. We lift this section of scripture up to you, Lord. I ask you to bless. I ask you to anoint. I ask you to mold us. I ask you to make us, Lord. Let us not lose this moment. Let us understand the importance. This, once again, we are at a point in time right now where our lives can be changed, can be forever changed right here, right now, based upon your word. If we would get in our heads that we can't do life the way we want to do life and expect the blessing of you upon it, that we've got to seek out what you say about it. I'm not going to stand in front of this people this morning, Father, and say I've got all these answers and know all those things because I have a hard time keeping up with all the things the Word of God says. But I am going to tell them that their pastor's seeking into the Word of God and looking into it to try to find out what those things are that you would have us to do, me to do, in individual situations. And if we're not all doing that together collectively, then we're just completely missing out. Well, we love you and we thank you. Challenge our hearts. Not attack us, but challenge our hearts to have better. And we'll give you the praise in Jesus' name. Everybody said, amen. The unexpected outcome. The Bible is a book of unexpected outcomes, isn't it? Story after story, there's a twist, there's a turn, there's something happens that nobody's ever heard of before. Noah and the ark. Okay, old dude spends 120 years building a boat out in the middle of nowhere, declaring to everybody that it's going to rain. Up until that time, I want you to get this, it had never rained. So Noah's running around telling them this fantastical story about how water that normally the Bible says had come up out of the ground, just a mist, like a big fog in the morning. That's how everything got watered. There was this misty fog every day that helped the plants grow and supplied all that. But Noah says, well, no, something different is going to happen. He said, there's going to be water falling out of the sky. And people are like, you are nuts in your head. Ain't never been no water falling out of the sky. The only way water's falling out of the sky is if Bob gets up there with a bucket and throws it down on top of your head. And I don't know what kind of Noah jokes they had, but I'm sure they had plenty of them. Amen? But then there was an unexpected outcome, wasn't there? when everybody's standing around, that first drop hit somebody's arm. Because the Bible's a book full of unexpected outcomes. Things that have never been seen before. Things that had never been done before. You see David and Goliath. You see a little boy against a giant. You see one sling, one stone, one throw, and one giant down. That was an unexpected outcome. You understand me? Matter of fact, even everybody on the Israelite side, as they watched this little dude walk out there with his sling and his stone, you know what they were thinking? They're thinking, he ain't coming back. He's not going to make it. Even the king is trying to give him his armament and stuff. Said, dude, you need to wear this because that big old boy is going to just beat you to death out there. David, no, there's going to be an unexpected outcome. We learned a new term for the word whaling ship when you get to the story of Jonah, didn't we? Huh? Where this guy's on his boat and he's trying to get away from the presence of God, and God's like, I don't have you going that way. He said, I need you to go this way. Causes a storm, they throw him overboard, and this whale that God prepared comes and swallows him up and takes him where he's supposed to go. That's an unexpected outcome, amen? I guarantee you nobody on the boat saw that happening. If you throw somebody in the middle of the ocean in the midst of some hurricane, you are not leaning on the edge of the thing going, well, I'm pretty sure a whale's going to come get him and take care of him and get him where he needs to go. Amen? That's not your mindset. That boy's going to drown. Amen? But this book is filled with unexpected outcomes. You've got a guy named Moses who is a castaway, a fugitive, and a wanted man back in a land that God sends him back into and uses him to deliver a nation. Imagine that. That is what? An unexpected outcome. Now, here's my point with all this. If everybody's listening closely to me, you would have never figured these things out. You would have never come to the conclusion that the story was going to end like this. Except God's revelation in his word to show you how it was. Correct? You've never been like, well, the whale, he'll be fine. The whale's going to get him. Amen? I'm sure this miraculous thing called rain, water's going to actually fall from the sky, and we're going to need that big 400-foot boat that's sitting in the middle of it because it's going to, and not, I mean, really that, you know, but it's going to rain that much enough to float this huge, huge, huge boat, okay? And not to mention just the fact getting past the idea that God's going to bring all the animals to get on it. Yeah, that's pretty good, okay. Huge unexpected outcome on that one, amen? I'm pretty sure that 15-year-old right there is going to take on that 7-foot, 8-foot tall, whatever dude, man, that is just enormous, and that he'll have no trouble taking him out. It'll be like nothing. Okay, same thing in your life. You don't know the outcome. You don't know how God's going to do in your life what he's going to get done, do you? You don't know the end of the story, do you? You don't know how it's going to turn out. But you know what? We get it figured out in our head, and then we run around depressed with our heads down, whining, crying, moaning, just completely frustrated and beside ourselves because we can't see how it's going to be. You know, the whole point is we don't have enough faith to just trust the God that loves you more than you love yourself to take care of you and get you where he has for you to go. And you know what? That's why you never end up there. Because you're trying to do it and you're trying to get where you want to go on your terms the way you want to do it. That's why there ain't no hills singing to you. There ain't no trees clapping to you. There ain't no random things just popping up and blessing you because you're walking at it and doing it the way that you want it to do. Amen? You say, well, what do I do? Okay, number one, quit that. How simple is that? Quit that. Quit it. I don't know how many times in my life, and I know in your life, you try to figure something out, you had it all figured out, you knew it was going to blah, 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 and it didn't turn out that way. And it didn't work out that way. And if you knew what was going on, you couldn't make that happen. And you know what? You wear yourself to a frazzle with all these thoughts and ideas. You can't sleep. You toss and turn. You worry. You fret. You go on with all this stuff. Well, I don't know what's going to happen. Well, welcome to the planet. Neither do the rest of us. Amen? And you know what? You're not going to lay in your bed at 3 a.m. and figure out what's going to happen, because you're going to have no more clue when you finally just can't stand it and fall asleep than you did when you started. Amen? There's only one that knows the end of the story. We need to start trusting him in these situations. Is your spouse, are your children, are your situations just too big for God to handle? But we act like it, don't we? And you put us to the test and we'll say, oh no, God can handle that. But in the back of our mind, we're thinking, but he hasn't, but he's not. I don't know how, I can't see how that one's going to change. I don't see how this is going to become different. That's okay. Didn't see the whale coming either. Amen. And then I'll give you the final one. You want to hear the biggest unexpected outcome? Two little words. I love these two words. You know who I serve? I serve a resurrected king. Who saw that coming? Nobody saw that coming, that one that had went to the cross and suffered and was abused and bled and died and was taken away and had been in the ground for 3 days, amen? Nobody saw that coming. But who is it you're following? Who is it you're praying to? Who is it you are lifting your hands in praise to? Who is it? It's that resurrected king, King Jesus, amen? The one that overcame death and rose from the dead. Talk about the unexpected outcome, and you claim to be a believer in that? You believe that he went to the cross, went to the grave, and rose 3 days later, and is now seated at the right hand of the Father, and that's who you're singing to up here when you're playing, and that's who you're praising in the aisles, and yet we can't trust him to take care of us? Yeah, amen. Unexpected outcome, absolutely. Jesus takes these things to task in Matthew chapter 6. And I want you to turn with me there, because I'm going to spend just a few minutes here. Because he knows where we live. And he knows how we are. And he uses the strongest thing he can come up with to get our attention. Matthew chapter 6, we're going to start in verse 24. The top thing on the planet, I'll make sure I'm wording this right. Understand, there still remains that gap of our way and his way, right? Heavens are higher, you know, like the heavens are higher than the earth, huge gap. But the consuming thought for most of us is our finances, our money, our supply, our homes, our vehicles, our jobs. You just got to have money, okay? Everybody say amen. You got to have money. I mean, you ain't got money, you don't get to eat. I mean, there's all sorts of really, really bad things that happen if you don't have money, correct? Let's just say it this way. It's important, amen? I mean, there's a reason that Miss Saunders out there in the middle of the night at, you know, blinking in the dark at 3:17 a.m. in the tool room, because she needs some money, amen? Because she wants to continue to eat and enjoy air conditioning and have a place to live, and it's just the way the planet's set up, amen? So it's not, people have like there's something wrong with that. God said the love of money is the root of all evil. When you get consumed with the idea of it and that's all you're pursuing and seeking after, that's when it becomes a problem. But yeah, you need some. Amen? Trust me. There's no question about that. You got to buy clothing. You got to have food. You got to have, you know, some place to lay your head at night. And you have to supply those things. So you have to have that. So Jesus goes right to that. To begin his comparison, he's like, number one, just in the basic human terms, one of the most important things on the planet is your finances, is your money, your ability to take care of yourself, supply for your children, you know, diapers, very soon to come, amen? Eventually, all those diapers you got at the baby shower, gone, trust me. They just disappear. Got to have some money. So in Matthew chapter 6, Jesus does this. He says, no man can serve two masters. For either he will hate the one and love the other, or else he will hold to the one and despise the other. You cannot serve God and mammon. And that word mammon means your riches and your possessions. So he goes immediately to the top tier thing, because God don't play. Amen? He says, but though you have to have money, he says, there can be that, but it can't be about that. He says, because you can't serve that and me at the same time. Now, here's the thought I want you to get. Do we trust in money more than we trust in God? If the bank account's built up good, we're looking down the road in the future, and all of a sudden you feel pretty relaxed and comfortable. Amen? All the notes are caught up, all the bills are paid, you got a little extra. Maybe you start thinking vacation. Peaceful, comfortable, content. You know what I'm saying? Account gets low, or like some, you know, if you got that overdraft protection. Amen? That can get you. Amen? I don't like that. That stuff irritates me. It's like, if I had enough money to do what I needed to do in the first place, that would be one thing. But you think that I'm so poor that charging me $24 or $33 so that I can get this done is somehow helping me. It's not helping me, amen? Huh? I think if you overdraft, they ought to give you $33. Oh, what about that one, huh? That's right, man. I'm already a pine, baby. Just beating me up when I'm down. Beating a man when he's down, amen? Help a brother out. Man, we getting those straight, so, and then we're just throwed off, amen? Huh? We throwed off, not easy to get along with, don't like anybody. Can't stand our spouse. Spouse can't stand us. Man, we just ain't got nothing. We ain't got nothing. Can't go to a movie. Can't get a burger. Can't do nothing. Amen? And we're all just back and forth based on that one thing. God says, you know what? You can't serve that and serve me. He said, you're either going to trust that or you're going to trust me, is what he's getting at. Okay? Now, in the NLT version, he talks about the fact that these things dominate the minds of the Gentiles. And I love that term. That having money, taking care of, you know, having power, having prestige, having the things that are necessary on this planet dominates the minds of the Gentiles or those that are lost. That's what they think about the new truck, about the four-wheeler, about the new barbecue pit, about the TV, about the house, about the clothes, about the vehicles, whatever it might be. All that stuff dominates their mind, and that their expression of who they are is based on who has the most toys. Amen? Jesus says, you can't serve that and serve me. Listen to verse 25. He says, therefore, I say unto you, take no thought for your life, what you shall eat or what you shall drink. What? What is that? I mean, surely he doesn't mean that, correct? Huh? Does he mean that? He says, take no thought for your life, what you shall eat or what you shall drink, nor yet for your body, what you shall put on. He said, don't be worrying about that. But that's not us. Do you know something? You know what I actually believe? I believe if Jesus was here now, there'd be a lot of people that claim to be his followers that would not follow him. You know why they wouldn't follow him? You know why they wouldn't follow him, Brother Billy? Because he ain't got no house. He ain't purchased no parcel of land. He ain't got no vehicle. He's running around in the same clothes he's been wearing. He's just staying from person to person's house each night. He don't even have his own little apartment anywhere. I mean, think about it. That's right. He said, the foxes have dens and the birds of the air have nests. He said, but the Son of Man has no place to lay his head. Listen, he was homeless. Are you getting that? Homeless. So I am following a homeless guy. Think about it. Aren't you? He was here on the planet. He didn't have a home. spent, you know, he lived in his father's home till he was 30, but once he got on his own, man, he was that, I mean, he didn't have a home. So I don't know, maybe he means what he's saying. Maybe I'm missing something. If the one who didn't have a home wasn't concerned about his clothing, wasn't concerned about what he was going to eat, wasn't concerned about what he was going to drink, because he was just running around trusting his father to take care of him, ends up telling me, quit worrying about that stuff. Maybe the fact that I still yet worry about it reveals that I'm somehow missing something. Because I don't know what you judge as success, but I'd say that in the end, Jesus was successful, amen? Because here I am still yet talking about him 2,000 years later, so there had to be something there, but I'm afraid that since God's thoughts are so much higher than mine, I just can't put my finger on it. And I don't want to be normal. I don't want to be just the quote-unquote average American Christian, whatever, bleh, just makes me nauseated just to think about it. So if there's something there that I need to see, then I want God to reveal that to me so that I can quit worrying about these things while I declare that I don't, amen, but I do. But if he's telling me not to, and he pulled it off, then what am I missing? I want you to feel that this morning. I don't want you to leave here just all satisfied and wow, that was a good message and wow, he was on it or whatever. I want you to leave with a hunger within you to say, how was that working? How did that take place? And how is it that I am following this one who was homeless? And why is it I would lay down my life for this homeless guy? Amen. I mean, I want to get down to the nitty-gritty of it, amen? I would lay down my life for my Jesus. Even though he would be so unaccepted by everybody in DeQuincy, Louisiana, basically. I mean, you let the homeless guy show up, come in here and start trying to tell you how to live your life and see how that works for you, amen? You can already feel that. You'd be like, come on, man. You ain't got a house. How you going to come in here and tell us how to live? Huh? He says, don't worry about these things. He said, verse 26, behold the fowls of the air, they sow not, neither do they reap, nor gather into barns, yet your heavenly Father feedeth them. Are you not much better than they? He said, he's taking care of the birds, he's taking care of all those things around you, they're all being supplied food. He says, don't you think he loves you more than he does them? Don't you think you mean more to him than they do? He said, now which of you by taking thought or which of you by worrying can add one cubit unto his stature? And basically he's just making it very simple. He said, what do you change by worrying? Nothing. He said, you can't change anything by running around worrying about stuff. Has it ever changed for you? I worried it back into shape, amen. I worried about it so much that it just straightened up. Anybody have that effect? Because if you did, you need to tell me about it. Amen. I need to know. Might have worried yourself sick. Might have made yourself cranky, unpleasant to be around, depressed, discouraged. But you never fixed anything that way. Matter of fact, good night. We could just sit here and get a piece of paper out and start writing down all the ways that we did stuff that never fixed anything. Some of you are still trying to do stuff and you're still not fixing it because you're still trying to do it your way instead of allowing God to do it. Either you don't have time or God doesn't understand or it doesn't, I don't know what in the world we think, amen? I know that's what God said, but what really needs to happen is this, and I need to do that because my spouse needs this, and my wife, my husband, my kids, they all this, that, and other, and I can't just sit back and do that. I mean, come on, that's just ridiculous. All right, you go ahead and call God a liar, see how that works out for you. You know what? 5 years from now, 10 years from now, 15 years from now, you're going to be stuck in the same repetitive routine because you never got off the ground and got up into the heavens up there where God's thoughts are and God's ways are to allow him to change anything because you wouldn't let him in, and then you have the nerve to act like he had something to do with it. Why won't we do what the Word of God says? Isn't it just, that's what we claim? He said in verse 28, and why take ye thought for raiment? Consider the lilies of the field. They grow, they toil not, neither do they spin. He said, yet I say unto you that even Solomon in all his glory was not arrayed like one of these. Wherefore, if God so clothed the grass of the field, which today is and tomorrow is cast in the oven, shall he not much more clothe you? Oh, and listen, here's his words. O ye of little faith. Yeah, there's our problem. He throws it right there in our face. You'll trust money in your bank account, but you won't trust me. Huh? I said this before. I said people that win the lottery just want to go to heaven. Yeah, people that win the lottery just want to go to heaven. I like doing that stuff. I like just throwing random things at you, and you're going, what in the world is he talking about? I said, well, because by winning the lottery, they think they're going to get everything that heaven affords. They're going to get peace and security and supply and protection. So that's where there's that desire. And you know what? That's what we think we're going to get by having fat bank accounts. We'll have peace and security and stability and supply, and everything will be okay. Amen? Doesn't matter that our children are still going to hell, that our marriage relationships are falling apart. At least I'm eating well and I get to go to any movie I want to. Huh? Because we're just that screwed up. We'll bandage everything up with a movie and a meal. Amen? Something, man, as long as I can go buy something, make myself feel pretty. It doesn't matter that my whole life around me is falling apart. We'll trust that money more than we trust God. We'll trust that big bank account more than we trust God. Jesus didn't have a bank account. I mean, there was one little dude that betrayed him running around carrying a little coin in his purse, coin in his bag, and the Bible says he was stealing out of that. Amen? So even the little bit of, yeah, that's right, old Judas was busy dipping into the bag. Even the little bit of money that Jesus did get from his collections, he had somebody stealing it from him. That's just rough, isn't it? That's a good thought, too, stealing from Jesus. What? I'm afraid I've been guilty of that. Just let it soak into your mind for a minute. Just imagine. It's all he had. No vehicle, no home, no car. Didn't have a closet. One pair of sandals. Huh? So yeah, he meant these things. He says, therefore, take no thought, verse 31, what shall we eat? What shall we drink? Wherewith shall we be clothed? For all these things the Gentiles seek. And that's where in the NLT it says, for all these things dominate the mind of the Gentiles. That's what they think about. You know, fine clothing, fine furnishings. You know, all the beauty, all the power, all the glory, all the display. Keeping up with the Joneses, making sure I got it too. We live in such a materialistic world, don't we? Huh? I mean, seriously. He says, but your heavenly Father knows that you have need of all these things. Seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you. What? What? Let me tell you something. Your success is not determined by the gold you possess, but it's by the godliness you possess. You know that? It is not determined by the gold you possess, but by the godliness you possess. You know? Think about that. This life is so soon going to be over. There's been so many people sit right where you're sitting right now that are no longer with us. Amen? They're off into eternity. You know where you're headed? Same place. Amen? You know, you're going to get out of here, and the whole point is, Colossians 3:1, if you then be risen with Christ, set your affection on those things that are above, where the Son is seated at the right hand of the Father. Jesus said, lay up for yourself treasure in heaven, where moth and doesn't eat and rust doesn't corrupt. He said, you lay your treasures up in heaven. Quit trying to get stuff here. Who cares about stuff here? It's more important. New car or good marriage. It's more important. New home or your kids are safe and saved. Amen. I guarantee you, when you step into eternity, you're going to suddenly realize what was more important. You know what? And the fact that we lack brokenheartedness about these things being all messed up shows once again that we're so separate from the one that's trying to give us all this stuff. Take therefore no thought for the morrow. He said, don't worry about tomorrow. He says, because tomorrow will take care of itself. Sufficient for the day is the evil thereof. You know what? I love that statement because you know I got enough stuff to deal with today for me to try to figure out what I'm going to do about tomorrow. Amen. So we got all these things running around. You've heard them, you know. Hey, you just, I used to have people when I was younger. They tell me, they said, well, you're just too heavenly minded to be any earthly good. Man, they tell me that. Because all I want to do is talk about Jesus. I want to talk about Jesus and getting people saved, and let's just do that. And they're like, well, you know, there's other things you need to be concerned with. And I'm like, I don't want to be concerned with other things. And you know what? I stand here before you today, and I'm just going to make it simple. I pulled it off, amen? I just kept seeking Jesus. Just kept wanting to see people get saved. And everything I possess doesn't belong to me. Think about it. Everything I have does not belong to me. That is not my house, but I get to live in it. It's not my church, but I get to roam all over the place. I even got the keys to this place. Amen? Huh? All the things. I mean, listen, I'm here to tell you. I'm trying to get that across. It works. You seek first the kingdom of God. He'll take care of you. He will take care of you. He will make adjustments in your life. He will work in your marriage. He will take care of your children. I was such a mess. Oh my goodness, you never believed it. Like I said, I've told you before, it took 3 years for my kids to even believe that I meant it. And now they're right with God. Now my grandbabies are going to church like they're supposed to. You can get that stuff back. If you've got a bad start, it's okay. God says, I can make up for a bad start. He said, but you have to have the right focus. Quit trying to work it out. Quit trying to manipulate them into doing stuff. Quit trying to force. Quit trying to take control of. And just let your focus be on me and seek first these things that I have for you to do. And as you go busy yourself doing them, I'll take care of all that stuff for you. Because I already know you have need of that. I already know it's breaking your heart. I already know you're concerned about it. I already know that you want to get it fixed. He said, but what I'm asking you to do is you take care of my business and let me take care of your business. Amen. Living example. It works. And I'm having a good time. Huh? I love you guys. This is fun, huh? I get to play in a praise band. I'm in a band. Not only am I the pastor, but I'm in a band. Amen. Come on, that's cool. Isn't that right? You know you like it? With the band, baby, huh? You get to do my guitar slides and come in at just the right moment. I love it, amen? And that guitar was given to me. It's not even mine either, amen? Just somebody gave it to me. The guitar, or the car I drove up here the first time in, somebody had given to me. Yeah. You know, people just don't give people cars. They do if you just follow Jesus, amen? I went to Kroger and Sulphur to get onion roll sandwiches because I love onion roll sandwiches, amen? You know what I'm talking about? The little onion rolls. Onion rolls, right? Cut them in half. You just put lunch meat and tomatoes and lettuce and cheese and all the onion rolls, amen? So I'm in there getting that because it's football season. I run into this guy I've never met before. We're both wearing the same T-shirt, okay? Some Christian T-shirt. We're both wearing the same T-shirt. He's got a long ponytail down his back. And he looks at me, and I look at him, and I'm like, hey, man, like your shirt, brother. Pretty cool. He's like yours too. We get talking. Lo and behold, he's the pastor of a place there in Sulphur called the Open Door Biker Church. Okay? His name's Vince Guidry. First time I ever met him. I got my little bag of onion rolls in my hand. I'm headed to the lunch meat and cheese area, amen? We get talking and he goes, you know, he said, it just occurs to me. He says, I'm going to tell you. He found out I'm a youth pastor. He said, well, I'm just going to share this with you. He said, I got a car I'm trying to give somebody. He said, I'm getting a pretty good idea who that might be that I'm supposed to give it to. Okay, I'm standing there I got this Toyota thing that's just went to overheating every time I drive it, okay? Make it about, until it gets to operating temperature, you're good. You can make the corn storm back, okay. But you get driving, it's going to overheat. So this has just started happening. And I'm sitting there, man, it's just like I'm just getting excited. I'm like, I think I know who you're talking about too, amen? So anyway, I go in for onion roll sandwiches and walked out with a car. That is an unexpected outcome. Amen? Don't you want to live like that? Then seek first the kingdom of God. And all these things will be added unto you. He'll do amazing things that'll just blow your mind. I love telling these stories. I love telling how God brought me through. I love giving him praise for what he's done in my life. And I never saw it coming. Amen. Amen. You know what? Never saw it coming. And all these things you're worried about right now, and let's get home with this right now. Let's get home with it right now. All these things you're worried about, all these things you can't figure out, all these things that are nagging, all these things that are continuing on, all these things that haven't resolved themselves. You give it to the Lord. You seek him first. You do what he has for you to do. And you trust him to give you an unexpected outcome. And take care of it, and you'll be like, I can't even believe that. I didn't even know I liked them anymore. Amen? I didn't even know I liked them anymore. My man Skeeter, unexpected outcome right here. I mean, we were talking about that the other day. We'd have been finger wrestling out in the parking lot about 2 years ago. Amen. Unexpected outcome. God just heals. God just changes. Amen. God, look at me. I'm just getting all glowy because that stuff is good. That's what God's trying to do in our lives. Let's stand. Miss Lolly, you get us a little something to play here. Drop the lights for us this morning. If you need that unexpected outcome, come. Come to this altar. Come talk to him about these things.
Here I am, down on my knees again.
A little volume on there, that's good. Here I am, down on my knees again, that's right. If you haven't got it yet, then you're not done praying about it. How about that one? If you have not received it yet, you're not done praying about it. Are you going to give up? Are you going to stop? Are you going to let it go? Are you going to back off? I encourage you this morning as your pastor, don't do it. It's not where you have for it to be yet. These altars are here.